Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala wa ba'd. So it pleases us here at Masjid Ashura in the state of Virginia, in the city of Norfolk, to present to you this Dora Ilmiya entitled Hada Minhaji, or This Is My Methodology. We have with us over the telephone a Shaykh Fawaz Al-Madkhali, Hafidhah Allah wa ra'a. And he's from those foremost students of the two Shaykhain, Shaykh Ahmed al-Najmi alayhi rahmatullah, wa kadhalik Shaykh Zayd al-Madkhali alayhi rahmatullah. And without further ado, we shall leave you with the Shaykh. Fa natarakukum ma'a Shaykh, fa tafadhal ya Shaykh mashkuran ma'jura.
Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد فنحمد الله عز وجل أن وفقنا في هذه المناسبة أن نلتقي بكم في هذه الدورة الطيبة هذا منهجي وهو اختيار عظيم ومناسب في هذا الزمن ومن خلال هذه الدورة يجب علينا أن نتواصى وأن نتناصح وأن يسدد بعضنا بعضا امتثالا لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الدين النصيحة وأحرى أن يمتثل هذه النصيحة هو طالب العلم خاصة تكون النصيحة بين طلبة العلم لأنها مطلب شرعي والدورات هي كما سمعت شيخنا الشيخ زيد المدخلي رحمه الله هي نوع من التجديد يعني لأنها تجدد أمر الدين فيجتمع فيها الطلبة ويسمعون الكلمات من هنا وهناك ويستفيد منها العام والخاص فهو نوع من أنواع التجديد فنسأل الله عز وجل أن يبارك في الجهود وأن يجزي خيرا من أنشأ هذه الدورة وأقامها وتعاون مع إخوانه فالكل مشارك سواء المشرف أو المدرس أو الطالب أو الحاضر أو المستمع هؤلاء كلهم مشتركون وفضل الله عز وجل واسع فأسأل الله عز وجل أن يجزي الجميع خيرا على هذه البادرة الطيبة التي تحيا بها القلوب نعم.
The Shaykh Hafidhah Allah wa ra'ahu, he began after mentioning Khutbat al-Hajjah. The Shaykh, he said that I praise Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala who has granted us the tawfiq on this particular occasion to meet with you all in this dora, and this dora which is entitled This Is My Manhaj. And this, no doubt, is a great occasion. It is a great topic and subject matter. And it is something which the people are in great need of, specifically within this time. He said, because as it's known that the Dawrat and the likes of these seminars and these lectures, then within them, people, they give beneficial advices. They give beneficial advices. And from the utmost of those people who should give beneficial advices to the people are the students of knowledge. He said, and so they advise one another mutually, and likewise they advise the people, taking the example from the Prophet alayhi as-salatu wasalam in the statement in which he said, "Ad-deen al-nasiha." The religion is al-nasiha, sincerity or sincere advice. And so this is something which is required within the legislation of al-Islam. And so within these dawrat, the Shaykh, he said that as I have heard from a Shaykh Zayd Al-Madkhali alayhi rahmatullah, that he said that these dawrat, they are a type of tajdeed, or a type of revival or renewal. They are a type of tajdeed, he said, meaning that they are a type of renewal or revival of one's deen. Because within these seminars, you are able to hear the statements of the scholars, and you are able to benefit one from another. And the benefit, it spreads by way of this. And so we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to bless the efforts of those who put together this seminar. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to reward them with the greatest reward. Because at the likes of these seminars, everyone shares in the reward. Whether that is the people who actually put the seminar together, whether that is the people who are delivering the lectures, or whether that be the people who come and attend the dawrah, or whether that be people who are listening via whatever means they listen. And so all of those people share a portion of the great and expansive bounty of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward with the best reward all of those who are connected to this particular affair. The Father Shaykh, and I'm mashkoor and ma'jura.
وهنا بعض النصائح والتوجيهات في بداية هذه الدورة المباركة. وأما أولى بهذه النصائح من غيري, ولكن من باب التذكير والنصيحة لبعضنا بعضا, فأقول الوصية الأولى بتقوى الله عز وجل. الوصية بتقوى الله عز وجل. فهذه الوصية قد وصى الله عز وجل بها الأولين والآخرين, وهي وصية جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين, فلا تصلح الحياة إلا بتقوى الله عز وجل. فالتقوى أن تجعل بينك وبين عذاب الله وقاية, وذلك بفعل الأوامر واجتناب النواهي. فإذا استشعر طالب العلم هذا الأمر فتح الله عز وجل عليه واستمر وصلح حاله, فحينما يفكر أن الله عز وجل يراقبه ويراقب أعماله وأفعاله فلا يقوم على معصيته ويزداد في المقابل من الطاعة فيتقرب إلى الله عز وجل, فتكون هذه دافعة له. هذا في التقرب إلى الله عز وجل. أيضا لا تحصل السعادة في الدنيا والآخرة لمن حرم هذا الأمر, ولا يحصل الترابط والتآخي والتكاتف والتعاون الصادق لمن حرم هذه الصفة وهي التقوى. فالتقوى أمر مهم دائما في أفعالنا وأعمالنا وفي تعاملاتنا وفي سلوكنا وفي أخلاقنا وفي قيامنا وقعودنا وحركاتنا وسكناتنا. فهي وصية الله عز وجل, يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. فهذه أو هذا الأمر يجب علينا أن نطبقه ونعمل به. فنحن دائما نسمع في خطب الجمعة ونسمع من المشايخ والعلماء الحث على التقوى, ولكن قليل من يطبق هذا الأمر, لأننا تعودنا على السماع أو الاستماع لهذا الأمر. فلابد أن نحاسب أنفسنا بأنفسنا ونجيب على هذا السؤال وعلى هذا الأمر إجابة مقنعة. من منا عمل بها وطبقها؟ نعم.
So the Shaykh Hafidhahullah, he said that so at the beginning of this Dawra, then we have a number of advices and directives. And the Shaykh said, perhaps I am more in need of these advices and directives than anyone else. However, from the standpoint of a tazkir or a reminder and advice, we're going to advise one another with these pieces of advice. And the first piece of advice is to have the taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. He said that the taqwa of Allah is actually the advice of Allah azza wa jal himself to the first and the last peoples. And it was the advice of all of the prophets and messengers. And the life of an individual cannot be rectified, it cannot be made or set aright, and not be upright, except by way of the taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the taqwa of Allah, it is that the individual placed between himself and the punishment of Allah, the hellfire, a barrier between himself and that. And it is likewise to adhere to the commands of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and to stay away from the prohibitions of Allah azza wa jal. And so for the student of knowledge, it is incumbent that he adorn himself with this characteristic, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will facilitate for him, and that he continue upon this way, having taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he always bears in mind and thinks about the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching him. And he's watching his statements, watching his actions, watching his movements. He's fully aware of all of these affairs. And the servant will not be able to have happiness in the dunya nor in the hereafter except by way of the taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And so the individual, he must be upon this particular affair in all of the aspects of his life, in all of his actions, all of his statements, all of his social interactions and dealings, likewise all of his movements, whenever he moves, whenever he is still, in every instance he must have taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has commanded us with this in the Quran, in which he said, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah as taqwa should be had of him, and do not die except in a state of al-Islam as Muslims. And so it is incumbent upon an individual that he always be upon this affair, and he always be upon the taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and that he strives to be upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, staying away from ma'asiyah, staying away from disobeying Allah azza wa jal, and striving to draw near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the reality of this affair. How often do we hear within the khutbah of al-jumu'ah, and how often do we hear from the mashaykh and the ulama, that they advise us with this particular affair, having taqwa of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. However, few are those who take that advice and apply it. Few are the people who hear that, and they take that advice, and they implement it within themselves. So we must reckon ourselves, call ourselves to account by ourselves. We must call ourselves to account by ourselves, and we must strive to be upon this affair constantly and in every instance of our lives. Now, I'm your Shaykh, tafadl.
النصيحة الثانية الاعتصام بكتاب الله عز وجل وسنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم على منهج السلف الصالح. التمسك بهذه الوصية والعض عليها بالنواجذ أمر مهم، لأن هذا مصدر تشريعنا الكتاب والسنة على فهم السلف الصالح. فالشؤون الدينية والدنيوية والعقائد والتشريعات والسياسة والأخلاق والسلوكيات والتعامل كلهم أو كلها تصدر من الكتاب والسنة، لكن على فهم السلف الصالح. لا خير في من يكون ليس على فهم السلف الصالح أو على فهم مخالف فهم السلف الصالح. فكثيرون يدندنون حول هذه الوصية، ولكن من يطبقها ومن يعمل بها؟ الجواب هم قلة. فالاعتصام هو سبب النجاة في الدنيا والآخرة. هؤلاء يدعون أنهم متمسكون بالكتاب والسنة ومنهج السلف الصالح، ثم تراهم يختلفون عليها وينحرفون عنها. وسبب الاختلاف والانحراف أنهم لا يطبقونها التطبيق الصحيح، لا يفهمون كتاب الله عز وجل الفهم الصحيح، أو السنة، أو فعل أو قول السلف الصالح، فهي مجرد دعاوى باللسان لا يعملون بها ولا يتحلون أو يتحلون بها في المجالس، ولكن في حقيقة أمرهم وحالهم هم أبعد الناس عن الكتاب والسنة وعن منهج السلف الصالح. إذن هذه الوصية، الاعتصام بالكتاب والسنة على منهج السلف الصالح رضوان الله عليهم، قولا وعملا واعتقادا ظاهرا وباطنا. فكما قلت، بعضهم يعمل بها ظاهرا فيقع في الخلاف ويقع في المشاكل ويقع في التفرق والتحزب بسبب عدم اعتصامه بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم على منهج السلف الصالح في الباطن والظاهر. نعم.
So the second pieces of advice, or the second of these pieces of advice that the Shaykh wishes to give, is al-i'tisam, to hold fast and cling to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih. Clinging to this and biting onto it with one's molar teeth is something which is highly important, because these two affairs, the Book and the Sunnah, they are the source of our legislation. They are the source of the Sharia, and we cannot be successful in our religious affairs or our dunya affairs except by way of it. So we must hold fast to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah in our deen, our affairs that are connected to the deen. Likewise, our dunya affairs, our politics, our mannerisms, our character, our social dealings and interactions, all of these affairs must be built and predicated upon Kitab and Sunnah. However, this is with the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih, because there's no good in that which departs from the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih. And we must ask ourselves, how many are those who apply this particular advice? And the answer to that is that they are few in number. They are few who actually cling to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salam with the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih. Because in reality, holding fast to these two affairs are the means for safety and security in this life as well as the hereafter. And departing from that will bring about differing and schism between the people. Because once the people depart from this understanding, then this is when you find differing and splitting amongst themselves. Whereas when the people hold fast to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah, and they hold fast to the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih, you find them to be together and united upon correctness. He said, many are those who make claim and talk within their gatherings and so on and so forth, and they make claims that they are upon Kitab and Sunnah. However, the reality of the affair is that they are the furthest of the people away from the Book and the Sunnah. They are the furthest of the people away from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah Messenger alayhi as-salatu wasalam. Therefore, this advice is an advice that is muhim. It is extremely important. And it is an advice that it is incumbent upon all of us to hold fast to this particular affair. Because when we depart from it, this is when we find hizbiyah. This is when we find separation and differing. This is when we find deviation away from that which is correct. Naam, ya Shaykh.
النصيحة الثالثة، الإخلاص لله عز وجل فطالب العلم وخاصة في هذه الدورة أذكره بهذه المسألة وهي النصيحة فلابد أن يخلص عمله لله عز وجل فلا يقصد به الرياء ولا السمعة ويدعو الله عز وجل أن يرزقه الإخلاص في القول والعمل وأن يهديه إلى الصراط المستقيم وأن يوفقه للحق ويبعده عن الخلاف فالخلاف شر فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يستعيذ بالله من بعض الأمور ومنها النفاق والشقاق وكان يسأل ربه التسديد كما جاء في الحديث اهدني لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم لو نظرنا إلى بعض السلفيين نجد أنهم لا يهتمون بهذا الأمر ولا يتوجهون إلى الله عز وجل لا أقول الكل لا إنما أقول البعض فتجده يرائي بأعماله ويعني يشهر هذا الأمر أمام الناس وأنه اشترك في الدورة الفلانية وأنه أخذ كذا وكذا بدون أن يطبق هذا العلم فهذا خطأ إلا إذا كان قصده التشجيع لبعض الطلبة أو الإخوة هذا لا شيء فيه إن شاء الله فنقول الإخلاص مطلب شرعي وكذلك أي عمل لا ينجح إلا بالإخلاص لو نظرنا إلى سيرة السلف الصالح من الصحابة والتابعين ومن تبعهم بعد ذلك الإمام أحمد بن حنبل وابن تيمية وابن القيم ومحمد بن عبد الوهاب وغيرهم ما هو سبب نجاح دعوتهم هو الإخلاص لله عز وجل فإذا أردنا أن نستفيد من العلم وأن نعمل به وأن نعلم غيرنا وأن نصبر على الأذى فيه فلا بد من الإخلاص لله عز وجل ولا نقصد به الرياء أو السمعة أو التكثر بشيء معين نعم.
And so the Shaykh of the Halai mentioned that the third of these pieces of advice that he wishes to give is al-ikhlas lillah, that the individual has sincerity for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. He said, especially the students of knowledge, and especially those who are within this particular dawrah. He said he wants to remind those who are involved in this dawrah, especially to have sincerity for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So your intention should not be riyah, showing off, or sum'ah, seeking to be heard about. He said, rather you must ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to grant you sincerity in your statements and in your actions. And ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to guide you to the truth. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he would make this supplication often. And he would seek refuge with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala from hypocrisy and misery. And he would ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to grant him uprightness in all of his statements and actions, for there has come inside of the narration that his dua that he would frequently make was, oh Allah, guide me to the truth regarding that wherein the people differ, and rectify my, or guide me to the straight path, for indeed you are the one to guide to the straight path. He said, and so when we look at the condition of some of the Salafiyun, we find that some of them do not give importance to this particular affair. The Shaykh said, I don't say that it's all of them, but some of them, they don't give importance to this particular affair. And so, they make their statements, or they do the actions which they do, hoping and looking for those actions or those statements to be spread and circulated amongst the people. And so they may come to a dawra, a seminar, the likes of this, and the only reason or the only concern of theirs is to say, you know what, I went to so-and-so conference. I went to so-and-so conference and I did this and I did that. But they're not applying what they learned inside of that conference. They're not implementing and applying that which they learned at that dawra. He said their only concern was to spread and circulate the fact that they did it. And they went there. He said, so therefore sincerity, ikhwan, ikhlas, it is a legislative requirement. And when we look at the seerah of the Salaf al-Salih, from the Sahaba and the Tabi'un, and likewise after them from the Imams, such as Imam Ahmed, likewise Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim and Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab, then what was the reason for the success in their da'wah? It was sincerity. It was the fact that they were sincere for Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And so therefore, it is incumbent upon us to, if we want success in this life and the hereafter, then we must be patient, and we must likewise be sincere for the sake of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. We must fight against our souls and ourselves to stay away from riya and sum'ah, seeking to be heard about. Rather, we do all of our actions and we make all of that sincere for the sake of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. The Fadl Shaykh and I'm mashkoor and ma'jura.
النصيحة الرابعة العلم. دائما نسمع العلماء ينصحون بهذا الأمر العلم، والمقصود به العلم الشرعي. كثير من السلفيين هو سلفي في المنهج لكنه لا يتقدم في العلم، فتراه يجهل بعض الأمور أو أبسط الأمور، لا يحرص على العلم ولا يتعلم ما يفيده في آخرته، فتجده يحرص على النزهة وعلى ضياع الوقت ويترك طلب العلم الشرعي. كنت دائما أسمع الشيخ زيد شيخنا رحمه الله يقول العلم تعطيه أغلى الأوقات، لأن بعض الطلبة كانوا يقولون له يعني أقرأ كتاب قبل أن أنام بنص ساعة، فالشيخ لا يعجبه هذا الأمر بل يغضب ويقول لا، العلم تعطيه أفضل الأوقات، هذا العلم أشرف شيء لأنك بحاجة إليه، ولأنه تنبني عليه الأسئلة الثلاثة في القبر عن الرب وعن الدين وعن الرسول. أيضا في العلم تحتاج إلى خشية، إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء، فالخشية أمر مهم يحملك على الخوف من الله عز وجل ومعرفة الحق من الباطل بتفاصيله، ومعرفة كيف تعبد الله عز وجل، ومعرفة كيف تتعامل مع الأحداث والمشاكل. كثيرا من المشاكل الآن التي تحصل في الساحة تجد أن مرجعها الجهل بالعلم الشرعي الصحيح، أو اتباع الهوى، أو التعصب، أو التقليد وإعجاب كل ذي رأي برأيه، كما في حديث أنس رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال ثلاث مهلكات: هوى المتبع، وصفح المطاع، وإعجاب المرء بنفسه. فالشاهد أن العلم الشرعي يرفعك الله عز وجل به في الدنيا والآخرة، يرفع الله الذين أوتوا العلم درجات، والآيات في فضل العلم والأحاديث في فضل العلم كثيرة، ولكن لابد أن نذكر بهذا الأمر وأن نحتسب المشاركة في هذه الدورة، وندعو الله عز وجل مخلصين له الدين في طلب العلم الشرعي، لأن النفس تحتاج إلى هذا العلم، وكذلك الناس يحتاجون، وخاصة في هذا الزمن، فأنت ترفع عن نفسك الجهل أولا، ثم تبقى
السلام عليكم شيخنا. اخيرا ايوه اخيرا ما سمعت قولك يعني ان القص من عيوم ان يرفع الرجل الجهل من نفسه.
انا اتكلم لوحدي يعني.
نعم.
طيب. سنقول على ان العلم فيه فائدتان. الفائده الاولى ان يرفع الانسان الجهل عن نفسه, والفائده الثانيه يرفع الجهل عن غيره. فبالعلم الشرعي يحصل الخير الكثير والسعاده في الدنيا والاخره, وخاصة في هذا الزمن الذي قل فيه العلماء وكثر فيه وتفشى الجهل والجهلاء. فحري بنا أن نجتهد وأن نجد في التماس العلم وطلبه على أهله وذويه, فنطلب العلم الشرعي مبتغين بذلك الأجر والثواب من الله عز وجل. نعم.
Now, so the Shaykh Hafidhullah mentioned that the fourth piece of advice is al-ilm, is knowledge, is that we have knowledge. He said, and often we hear from the ulama that they advise with this particular affair of seeking knowledge. And what is intended by way of ilm is ilm shar'i, is legislative knowledge. Legislative knowledge. He said that often we find that an individual, he may be Salafi in terms of his manhaj. You know, he's Salafi, he's upon the way of the Salaf in terms of his manhaj. However, the individual, he is ignorant regarding the affairs of his religion. He is not diligent upon seeking knowledge. Rather, he abandons that, and you find him to be diligent upon entertainment and diligent upon wasting time. Often we would hear our Shaykh, Shaykh Zayd Al-Madkhali, alayhi rahmatullah, he would say knowledge should take up the majority of your time. Knowledge and seeking knowledge should take up the majority of your time. He said that if the Shaykh would see a student and he would say, for example, this student, I'm going to read for about a half hour and then I'm going to sleep after that, the Shaykh would not like these particular affairs. He would like to see the students dedicated and devoted to seeking knowledge, because knowledge, it takes up time. It takes time to acquire. He said, so he would say that knowledge requires the majority of your time. He said, and we should especially seek knowledge regarding the affairs of the Aqidah. Affairs such as those questions that you're going to be asked inside of your grave, regarding who was your Lord, who was your Prophet, and what was your religion. He said, and knowledge, it brings about the fear of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. When an individual has knowledge, it brings about fear of Allah Azza wa Jalla. As Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentioned within his book, that it is only those who have fear of Allah, the ulama. Those who have ilm, the people who have knowledge, they are the ones who fear Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And so, this is what knowledge does. It brings about the fear of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And it enables the individual to know truth from falsehood. It enables the individual to be able to worship Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala correctly upon insight, and to know the reality regarding affairs. He said that, and when we look at many of the mashakil and the problems that occur in the arena of Islamic propagation and the likes of this, then we find that the majority of that goes back to ignorance regarding the religion. The majority of that goes back to ignorance regarding the religion, or it goes back to desires that are followed, or it goes back to a taqleed, blindly following other people, or giving precedence to the opinions of men. Such as come in the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, in which it was mentioned that there are three things that destroy. There are three things that destroy. Firstly, desires that are obeyed. Likewise, an individual being upon sin and transgression, And likewise, a person being amazed with himself. Or, ignorance regarding the affairs of the religion, desires that are obeyed, and a person being amazed with himself. These three things destroy. Knowledge, ikhwan, it raises and elevates people. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala said that Allah will elevate in degree those who have taqwa of Allah and those who have knowledge. He said, and many narrations have come regarding the virtue of knowledge and the importance of it. However, it is upon us to be sincere in the seeking of knowledge. And we must know that knowledge, it is sought for, or has two benefits. It has two benefits. The first is that one removes ignorance from his own self. When you attain knowledge, you remove ignorance from your own self. And the second is that you remove ignorance from other people. He said, and by way of knowledge, we are able to acquire an abundance of goodness and likewise happiness in the dunya as well as the hereafter. He said that oftentimes we find, he said that especially in this particular time in which we live, where those who actually have knowledge are few and the ignorant are in abundance. And ignorance is widespread. And so it is upon the people to seek religious knowledge and to fear Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala within themselves. نعم يا شيخ.
النصيحة الخامسة والأخيرة لزوم أكابر العلماء. فهذه من الوصايا التي أوصي بها نفسي في هذا الزمن أن نكون مع العلماء الكبار المعروفين بالتصدي للدعوة السلفية والذب عنها وعن حياضها والرد على أهل الأهواء والبدع. فبفضل الله عز وجل في كل عصر نجدهم. ففي عصرنا هذا مشايخ كثر، ومنهم الشيخ ربيع المدخلي حفظه الله، والشيخ عبيد الجابري حفظه الله، وغيرهم سواء كان منهم الأحياء أو الأموات. قال عبد الله بن مسعود: لا يزال الناس بخير أخذ العلم عن أكابرهم وعلمائهم، فإن أخذوه عن صغارهم وصرارهم هلكوا. منهم أيضا الشيخ صالح فوزان، الشيخ صالح الحيدان وغيرهم. فنقول هذه القاعدة مهمة يجب أن تكون عندنا أو على البال. نأخذ العلم عن الأكابر. أما الأصاغر الذين هم أصاغر في السن أو أصاغر في البدعة فهؤلاء نتركهم لأنهم دعاة فتنة وعليهم ملاحظات. فنحن إذا أردنا أن ننجو بإذن الله انتهينا ما قاله ابن مسعود: لا يزال الناس بخير ما أخذ العلم عن الأكابر. وخاصة من الأكابر الذين ينشرون العلم ويبينون الحق ويردون على أهل البدع بكل هدوء وبكل صراحة. نأخذ عنهم المنهج الواضح. ومن هؤلاء كما قلت الشيخ ربيع المدخلي حفظه الله، فقد شهد له العلماء السابقون واللاحقون الآن في هذا الزمن وفي هذا العصر أنه رجل تفرد في هذا الباب. لا يتكلم في أحد من باب العصبية أو الانتقام أو الإسقاط أو التعظيم أو غير ذلك أو الحسد أو غير ذلك من الشبه التي يلقيها شياطين الإنس والجن. قال عنه الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله: حامل غاية الجرح والتعديل في هذا الزمان. وقال الشيخ مقبل عنه كذلك رحمه الله: من حكم عليه الشيخ ربيع لأنه حزبي فسيظهر بعد ذلك لأنه حزبي. لأن الشيخ ربيع له نظرة ثاقبة وله خبرة في هذا المجال وعنده علم كثير ولديه احتكاك بهذه الجماعات، يتميز عن غيره من العلماء ممن ليسوا على هذا القدر الكبير في التعامل في هذا المجال وهو الرد، وكلهم ولله الحمد مشايخ فضلاء لكن يتفاضلون، وذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء. الشاهد أننا نلزم غرض العلماء الكبار ونبتعد عن الخلاف وندعو إلى التآلف والمحبة والتآخي على طريقة مشايخنا، وأسأل الله عز وجل أن يصلح الأحوال وأن يفتح علينا وعليكم أبواب العلم النافع والعمل الصالح، وأن يقينا وإياكم شر الأشرار وكيد الفجار. صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
نشكركم شيخنا على هذه الكلمة الطيبة، ونسأل الله أن يجعلها في ميزان حسناتكم يوم القيامة.
وإياكم وإياكم بارك الله فيكم على هذه الدعوة، وأسأل الله أن يوفقنا وإياكم لما يحب ويرضى.
آمين آمين آمين، حياكم الله شيخنا.
حياكم الله في أمان الله.
حياكم الله، السلام عليكم.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. So the Shaykh, he mentions that the fifth and last of these advices is to be diligent in holding fast to the major scholars, to the senior scholars. He said, this is something which I advise myself with specifically in this time, is to be with the senior scholars, to be along with the senior scholars. He said, those who are known for the Sunnah, they are known for the da'wah, the Salafiyyah, and for defending it, for calling to it, and known for refuting Ahlul Bid'ah and Ahlul Ahwa in every time and every place, he said, but especially those who are in this particular time. And the scholars, they are very many, and from the most eminent of them, Shaykh Rabi' ibn Hadi Al-Madkhali, likewise Shaykh Ubaid Al-Jabri, and other than them, whether those scholars be alive or dead. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that you will continuously be in a state of goodness and blessing as long as you take knowledge from your seniors. Because when you take knowledge from the asagir, from the smaller ones, then you shall be destroyed. He said, and likewise from those senior and major scholars, as Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, as Sheikh Al-Uhaydan, and other than them. He said, and this is an important principle that we hold fast to, is taking knowledge from the senior and eldermost scholars, the major scholars, those who are known for refuting the people of innovation and then in calling to the Sunnah, and they refute Ahlul Bid'ah, and they do it with an open heart. They refute the people of innovation, and it's something which they feel no qualms about it. He said, for when we depart from these major scholars and these senior scholars, we will find ourselves in fitna. Those who depart from them, they are people who we find them to be engaging in fitna and the likes of these mudaharat and demonstration and the likes of that. Forgetting about the statement that we just heard of Ibn Mas'ud, that you will continuously be in a state of goodness as long as you take from the senior scholars. He said, and from those specifically who are known in this regard for defense of al-Islam, defense of the Sunnah, refuting the people of Bid'ah and the Jam'iyat, is a Shaykh Rabi' ibn Hadi al-Madkhali alayhi hafidhahu Allah ta'ala. This man is one whom the major scholars have testified on his behalf that he is a man who is unique in his field. He stands alone in his field. And when he refutes people, he does not do so based upon asabiya. He does not do so based upon tribalism and favoritism or envy and jealousy. He does not refute people except due to defense of their religion. He said, this is a doubt that some of the people they try to bring in regarding Shaykh Rabi'. And this doubt comes from the shayateen amongst mankind and the jinn. Whereas you have Al-Imam Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah said concerning Al-Sheikh Rabi' that he is the flag bearer, the standard bearer of the science of jarh wa ta'dil. Likewise, Al-Sheikh Muqbil rahimahullah said concerning Al-Sheikh Rabi' that if Sheikh Rabi' says about a person that he is a Hizbi, then just wait a little while, it's going to become crystal clear that person is a Hizbi. He said, and so this is a person who has spent his life and he has aged and grown old in the affair of calling to the Sunnah, propagating that, and he likewise has precedence and he likewise has knowledge regarding the groups and the people of innovation, and he is distinct in this particular field. And he said that, and all of the scholars, they are virtuous. All of the scholars, they have great virtue, but however, some of them, they stand apart from others. And they vary, and they are varying in their levels. And this comes from the variation that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he gives, and distinction that he gives to certain individuals amongst others. He said, nah, and so, as long as we hold fast to this particular affair, then we will be upon goodness. And when we depart from this particular affair of holding fast to the major scholars and the senior scholars, then we will find differing amongst ourselves and deviation and the likes of that. But as long as we hold fast to them, we will find mutual love. We will find mutual brotherhood. We will find uprightness upon that particular affair. And now, this is what the Shaykh had concluded with. And the Shaykh, he rounded off his lecture, making dua, asking Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who have beneficial knowledge and likewise righteous actions. And he supplicated for everyone who attends at the Dora. And he rounded off his lecture with this. Hada wa sallallahu sallam wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.